when it comes to multiplication and division of mixed fractions, it's kind of less, well, I think less worth in looking at the kind of flexibility that we had with addition and subtraction. So remember, with addition, we could just add the whole numbers separately and then add the fractions separately and put these together. With subtraction, it was sometimes easier to break one of the whole numbers and combine it with the fraction to make an improper fraction that then made subtraction possible. I mean, there are ways to decompose the multiplication. So if we think of it even as similar to multiplying 10, you know, double-digit numbers. So if you have, for instance, 35 times 21, one way of breaking this down into simpler problems is we kind of do 30 times 20, 30 times 1, so that's 30 times 21, and then the 5 times 21 and the 5, sorry, 5 times 20 and 5 times 1. So we break it down into that kind of way, and we can do that. We can do 3 times 2, which is equivalent to this 30 times 20, and we can do 3 times a seventh, and so get our, you know, 3 times 2 plus 3 sevenths plus 4 fifths times 2, which gives us 8 fifths, and then plus the 4 fifths times a seventh. So, we could break it down this way, but I tend to think usually it's going to be more worth for us to just convert them into improper fractions, and then the multiplication steps are somewhat easier. It does mean that sometimes we'll get left with multiplications that we can't necessarily do mentally, but for what we need multiplication for, and the likelihood and amount that we're going to be multiplying or need to do this by hand, I think probably the most straightforward way is just to learn it in terms of improper fractions. So let's get rid of all this and let's get underway. Okay, so focusing first on this one here. So as a general rule, what we can do is first convert these into improper fractions. So that means that we're going to have 3 times 5 because there's 5 fifths in every whole. So 3 times 5 plus 4 on 5, so that's how many fifths we have, multiplied by 2 times 7 plus 1 on 7. Simplify that and we'll get 19 fifths. Multiplied by 2 times 7 plus 1 is 15 on 7 here. So we get 19 on 5 times 15 on 7. And we do this just by multiplying the top two numbers and multiplying the bottom two numbers. I remember from our classes the justification behind this, so it's probably easier to understand when we have kind of smaller fractions. But if we're multiplying 2/3, so we have kind of 2/3 here, and we want to cut it in half, we see that the bottom number gives us the size of our pieces, so that would give us sixths, and then the top is kind of the count of what we have here. So same justification, it's just a little bit more difficult to see when you're breaking down improper fractions, but it's still just going to be multiply top, multiply the bottom numbers. Now there is a nice thing that makes things slightly easier for us here, and we can do what's called cross-simplification. So we can convert this to 1 and this to 3. Now, why are we allowed to do that? The basic reason is due to a property for multiplication which is called commutativity. And this is basically the rule that, you know, 3 times 5 is the same as 5 times 3. It's that the order that you take the two arguments in doesn't matter. We still get the same thing. So multiplication is commutative, so is addition. So that means with this question here, as it was posed, 19 times 15 on 5 times 7 is the same as saying 15 times 19 over 5 times 7. So just swapping the order around here. And then, of course, this 5 on 15... we should be able to recognize has an equivalent fraction. It's just the same as 3 on 1 times 19 on 7. So this is implicitly what we're doing when we're doing this cross-simplification, where we can cross out diagonally as well as up and down when we do these kinds of questions. And it makes, you know, for us, it makes things much, much easier because now we can just have 19 times 3, which will be 57, because 20 times 3 equals 60, so that means 19 times 3 will just be 3 less than that, so 57. So we get 57 on 7. And as our last step, we're going to just simplify that. 7 goes into 57 8 times, and 1 seventh left over, because 8 times 7 is 56. So, in summary, for multiplication, the basic steps that we're usually going to be following is just first convert to improper fractions, and then multiply, and so simplify if we can. So doing that cross simplification, or up and down simplification obviously can help as well. And then lastly, we can just, again, simplify or convert to a mixed number. Now, the main reason, I haven't necessarily focused on this explicitly as well, you know, there's no reason why a mixed number is necessarily better than an improper fraction. So looking at these representations that we have at the end here, the main reason why we probably like mixed numbers better is just because it gives us a better feel for how big the number is. On the other hand, you know, when we're working with fractions, often the improper fraction, I mean, we see we convert these into improper fractions in order to do all of these steps, usually works better, but our final answer is so that we know, you know, have an intuitive feel for how big it is, it's best to convert it into a mixed number. Now with division, same thing essentially applies, but of course with division we have to follow that extra step, but still I think the best way is just to convert into improper fractions first and then apply our methods. So here, to convert to improper fractions, we're going to have 5 times 3 plus 1, which gives us 16 thirds in the top there, because we've got 3 thirds for every whole, so there's going to be 15 in the whole fives, and then an extra one at the end, and then divided by, that's not a division, so divided by, and then 6 times 5 is 30 plus 2 over 5, so here we've got divided by 32 on 5. Now, remember with division, our rule is to convert this into a multiplication and flip 32 and flip our divisor. Now, again, this is hard to understand why this process works. Some ways that I often think of in order to kind of justify it, remember if you're dividing by 2, and remember 2 is the same as 2 on 1, that's the same as multiplying by a half. So dividing by 2 is the same as multiplying by a half. Dividing by a half is the same as multiplying by 2, because there's 2 halves in every whole, and so when you say how many halves, it's the same as doubling, because there's 2 for every one that you have. So there is this definite relationship that we have between division and multiplication in terms of reciprocals. So it's probably the easiest way to think about it. There's other ways as well to justify it, but they involve probably a little bit more algebra than is necessary. And so for us, just think of these kind of things. As well, when we look at the base 10 system, we looked at some of that index notation. So remember, when we divide by hundredths as well, it was the same as multiplying by 100. And dividing by 100, of course, is the same as multiplying by 1 over 100. So there is this link between multiplication and division that we can keep track of. Now, once we have it in this multiplication form, again, Our numbers are nice enough to us in this case where we can save ourselves a little bit of multiplication by doing this cross division. So dividing in this direction, we can divide by 16, so we get 1/3 now times 5 on 2, and that will just give us 5 on 6 as our final answer. If we didn't do that, then we would have to have done 16 times 5, which gives us 80, and then 3 times 32, which gives us 96, and then we would have had to divide down, and you know, our common factor for 80 and 96 is actually our 16, and so we'd get 5 on 6 again. Okay, so I hope that's a little bit useful, both in kind of consolidating some of the operations that we have with fractions, but also seeing how mixed numbers and improper fractions fit in with those things. We can also see with all of these operations, you know, why it's so important to be comfortable with that conversion between mixed numbers and improper fractions. So we often need improper fractions in order to be able to perform operations better, but again, the mixed number representation is more intuitive for actually understanding how big a number is. I hope you're having a good week, and I'll see you soon.